do not necessarily reflect those of the Way Broadcasting Corporation or the staff and management of WFBR.
Legalize it. Don't criticize it. Of instrument too. Legalize it, yeah, yeah, that's the best thing you can do.
You get the point on this great afternoon. That was Peter Tosh, Legalize It. And that's a conversation that we're going to have on these Thursdays from 2 to 3 p.m. So grateful again to Little Africa and famous 1590 for just the innovative thoughts and ideology to have this type of program. Because you know what? We're not speaking about this everywhere. And specifically in communities of color, we're still in the taboo phase of no. Cannabis, no. Some of you might feel that it's a gateway drug. I'd love to have that conversation with you. But at the end of all of it, it is a business of the cannabis industry. the billion-dollar international industry. And that's what we're going to talk about. A lot of people across this country have had the opportunity to be in workshops and sometimes the only woman of color in a conference of 10,000 individuals. And then the only person of color in the room, period. So it lets you know that there's something about this industry where so many of us have been incarcerated, still incarcerated, that we are missing the boat. And yes, I said it, because at the end of the day, there's an opportunity with a legislation to expunge records, to gainfully employ individuals who have been wronged by the war on drugs. But maybe you all forgot about all that. Maybe you forgot about the whole Reefer Madness campaign in the 60s. You all remember that? And then they had this horrific kind of music, dun, 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 in the background. They showed this woman, and as soon as you took a tote, you're going to go mad, and everyone was going to do all these heinous crimes into the community. And so now that same industry, if you look at it, and maybe this is something that'll help get you interested, enlighten you, that Maryland, as reported by Gondrepreneur, this wonderful state of Maryland raised $21.7 million from cannabis taxes. Let me say that one more time to you again. $21.7 million from taxes. Now, you know, Maryland has only approved the medicinal component of cannabis right now. Not even thinking about recreational. I believe in the next year or so, recreational will be an opportunity for these amazing citizens to be able to discuss and determine if they want, because at the end of the day, we have over 30 states, and I'll give you the details of those states that have approved medicinal, and then we have some 10 plus who have approved recreational. And so that means that this billion-dollar industry is upon us. But the data shows that Maryland's medical cannabis industry has generated about $21.7 million in tax revenue for the state. And this was based on Beacon Economics Report. And I know you're going to have some questions, so let me slow down a little bit. I'm going to give you our call-in number, if you don't mind. The call-in number is 410-761-1592. One more time again, 410-761-1592. Now, you all might say, Colette, where did this come from? Who are you? Let me give you a little bit about who I am. Had the pleasure of being in Maryland from Detroit. I hail from Detroit, Michigan, for about the last 5 months, and actually was brought here to do some political strategy and realized that, you know, when they always tell you, when you get lemons, make lemonade. And so I realized that this was an open market to discuss this industry that I've been a part of for the last 5 years. If you were so inclined, and if you'd like to, you can go to www.cannabiz.tv, cannabiz.tv. And that's cannabiz.tv. Cannabis, a lot of times you all think it starts, we spell it with C-A-N-N-A. But however, the original Greek spelling began with a K. So Kanna Biz TV is the TV news web portal that I created to educate us about the business of the cannabis industry. I was fortunate 5 or so years ago to just realize, with the innovative thoughts and support of my family, my parents, a great afternoon to you all, because we weren't raised with the no concept. The amazing show prior to was talking about us really reclaiming our roots and who we are and an understanding of who we are. And so I was fortunate to be raised with parents who, as big as you could dream, you could accomplish it. And that you were first an American to understand your rights. And then we happened to be of African descent and indigenous people descent. We came off of the Ozark Mountains in Batesville, and my great grandmother came off the Trail of Tears out of Oklahoma. So we have an innate a connection to this land. And I think so many of us don't even realize and claim that we are Americans. And so there's an ideology that comes with that, because you should not have less than. You should not be in a space where what they can do. We hear that all the time. Remember, I'm coming out of Detroit. Okay, so we know that Detroit, you all remember the emergency management, you know, what the bailouts look like. You know, so many people from the South and other regions moved up to this big city so they could partake in the automotive industry, where they could get $5 a day and really create an opportunity for themselves and their families. But throughout all those years, I've consistently heard, we can't, they won't let us. And I always wonder, who's we can't? Who's they? I believe that you have a mindset of what you can accomplish. And the truth is, so many of us are indoctrinated. We're indoctrinated. I was deliberate in that. Because at the end of the day, we take in what we're told. We regurgitate that information. We don't think. We don't analyze it. Noam Chomsky always says, as a man thinketh, it's what they say. So if it's what they say, we prescribe to everything that we've been told, and then we don't think that we can do anything. But the truth of the matter is, people of color, black folk, African descent folk, we made America. Blood, sweat, and tears, America has been birthed and sustains itself through us. And so now we have this billion-dollar industry that those of us are still incarcerated, or if we're out, we have records that haven't been addressed that we in our communities are afraid to touch because we're just afraid. We live in fear. If you know anything about this industry, Illinois passed legislation that will expunge 800,000 records. That's almost a million records for individuals who had crimes associated with cannabis. So that means we have individuals who will be able to become gainfully employed, to be able to get loans to go to school, because those records will be cleared out. And the truth of the matter is, I believe that if we have individuals who are, of course, the clergy, took more of an interest in that, because I've had conversations, I've had some very heated dialogue with our wonderful clergy men and women who said, Colette, well, you're just pushing the drug. I said, no, I'm pushing the legislation that will empower the people because of the drug. So you could use this conversation to expunge records so maybe they can get jobs and maybe they can come and have more tithe and offering into the storehouse. But maybe that's something you might not want to talk about, but I'm going to mention one today, because ultimately the goal is to educate, enlighten, and empower you. I'm going to say that again. I promise you that when our time is up every week, you will be educated, enlightened, and empowered. So let me go on a little bit more about my story. And so, of course, I thought that I was able to forecast and foresee something happening in this arena. I had the pleasure of being educated from the Wharton School of Business, University of Pennsylvania, Quaker, Ivy League. And so it's a different mindset. We were taught to understand the importance of communications, networking, and money. No matter what the product or service is, as long as you understood the relationships, that ability to engage, what that looks like, networking, and then where the money fit in, you know, they always say in business school, it's a widget, whatever you want to do with it. And so I had that experience coming off of the East Coast and had an amazing career in various industries, advanced work for the White House, mergers, acquisitions. So I understood politics. No matter where I was, you had to understand the political nature of things, the legislation, what that looks like specifically to how we're governed in society. And so one day I was having a conversation with my dad, and he said, well, you know what, Colette, in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. I said, Dad, you're killing me. Here we go. Like, what is that? He said, in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. So either you can be in a space where you are on the proverbial hamster wheel of going and being in the same space with people with same education, same pedigree, or you can think about coming back to Detroit where people might not have had those experiences and start something anew. And so I went back to Detroit because that's what I know. And then I jumped back into politics because that's what I know. And in the midst of that, there was a rumblings about this cannabis thing. I said, oh, you mean marijuana? Oh, you mean weed? Oh, you mean pot? Oh, you mean hashish? Oh, you mean hemp? And in that, it was just like an aha moment. And I was fortunate enough to be able to take classes online and get certifications and start having the conversations, but I knew it was a little bit too much for Michigan, specifically for people of color. And yeah, I said it, because we didn't want to have that conversation. But I kept pushing forward and then developed into an actual television platform that you'll be able to experience if you're on cannabis.tv, where I shared a lot of information about what this industry looks like. And a lot of people will say, you know, they're apprehensive about these types of conversations because they believe that they're opinionated. No, sir and ma'am, it's factual. The legislation that I'll present to you, it's legislation. It's not opinions. The reports that we'll discuss from the medicinal uses of cannabis, that's factual. The recreational components of legislation that then produces products and services, and what the banking industry looks like, and how Congress is assessing the Safe Bill Act, and all of those things, those are facts. So I'm not going to sit and pontificate of what I think it is. I'm going to share with you what is literally on pen and paper to be able to say, hey, how can you, if you have an interest in this industry, make it work for you? A lot of you over our course of the conversations, you'll say, well, Colette, I mean, all they talk about is a dispensary. Well, let me tell you, there's so many ancillary businesses that support this industry. You'll be apprised of that. The dispensary is, I believe, now this is where I use my opinion. I believe that is the most costly entree into the market is through a dispensary. Do you know there's so many other ways to be able to support this industry? So let me tell you, for example, there's transportation, there's security, there's actual real estate, there's actual the ducts, the lighting, the structural, the components that support the grow. There's the products and services that support the grow. Like, did you all know that Miracle-Gro, you remember Miracle-Gro? Back in the day, your mom used to say, oh, water the plants, put some Miracle-Gro in there. Miracle-Gro has a partnership with Kanna Biz, and they are providing the Miracle-Gro and the fertilizers for grows internationally. Ha ha. There's an investment component of that, because if you have stock, Miracle-Gro is publicly traded. So if you had stock, then you would get a reap of return on your investment, because I guess that's used in this industry. So you have a whole stock component of it. Then you have this FDA approval of drugs specific to what? Cannabis. And so there's a drug that's approved right now. We'll talk about that. That's on the market, FDA approved. Come on. And if you say, Colette, I really don't want to think about it that way, then I'll say, well, let's go to hemp. So hemp is that non-psychoactive part. That's the part that doesn't get you high. But there are benefits to hemp. You all remember back in the day, George Washington, the president, George Washington, had slaves. He was a hemp farmer. Hemp was huge an industry. So much so now there's the Farm Bill Act that was approved. And you know that hemp is the only substance that is approved federally for transport. You can cross state lines with hemp. You can ship hemp. That is the resurgence of this whole farm industry right now. Did you know that? And at the end of the day, specifically for people of color, we were farmers. So we went through the produce, we had tobacco, we had all these other components, but now hemp has made a resurgence. And then what do you use hemp for? Hemp is used for concrete, it's used for clothing, it's used for beverages, it's used for CBD. You all know about CBD. CBD addresses everything. Your ailments, your arthritis, your skin, you name it. CBD is the hottest thing going on right now. Did you know that? It's derived from hemp. And so those are the conversations that we'll have, because I don't want you to think that this is not an industry that you can be a part of, but we're not having the conversations. I'm going to go on and give you some more facts. I could talk about any other state and internationally, but I wanted to hit home in Maryland. Beacon Economics reported that, of course, as I stated earlier, we raised $21.7 million for tax revenue in this state. But what was the major issue associated with that? It was that there was not an adequate representation of people of color. I'm going to specifically read to you what the article states, that in 2018, the state legislature passed a bill to expand the number of medical cannabis licenses available following a push by members of the legislature to open up licensing to minority-owned firms. After some lawmakers criticized the first round of licensing for not approving any minority-owned firms. Did you get that? That's where social equity comes in. That means that there has to be something that's a set aside, some kind of level of consideration that is for those individuals who are disenfranchised, disadvantaged. And a lot of times you all think that it has to do that everything in America is based off of color. It's really about class. Now, for those of us who are people of color who then fall into a lower socioeconomic status, and yes, there are two components to that. But at the end of the day, if you are sitting here and someone says, for example, I'm going to go back to Michigan. So Michigan has 19 cities that they've identified as those who are specific to social equity. And those same 19 cities are those who were seized by emergency management. We can talk about emergency management. Some interesting things are happening in Maryland right now with emergency, the idea of having emergency management as it pertains to violence and crime. And so I can talk to you about that, because Michigan experienced some 15 plus years of emergency management, and it wasn't the best thing for us. But suffice to say, the 19 communities that were seized by emergency management were communities of color. And so now those are same ones on the books that A, their social equity component states that you'll get a discount in fees and you'll have the opportunity to have someone help you fill out the application. Well, for example, if I was interested in a dispensary back in Michigan, then the actual asset valuation that I need to be able to show is $250,000. So I have to be able to show that I have personal $250,000 assets for me to be able to consider filling out an application. So guess what? If I'm one of those residents in those 19 communities, I don't have $250,000 to be able to show on paper. So your discount for me really doesn't matter. So you think you're giving me something. A, if I don't have the money and I don't have the discount, does it matter at all? So you saying you're going to help me fill out the application, that's going to be my foray into this industry. No, ma'am and sir. And it's no different in this market. And so we sit back and we watch. And maybe sometimes, maybe it's so close to you all here that you really don't see it and you really haven't thought about it because you're so mired in everything else. Do you know everyone that I've encountered here, the first thing they say to me is, why would you move to Baltimore? Why? I would never move here. I'm doing everything I can to get up out of here. And I thought about it and I said, you know what? So many times when we're right in the trenches, we're right in the thick of it, you can't even see what's around you because you're mired in the day to day. And you're mired in the concept of a hopelessness. But I'm here to tell you that that's not the case. Let me tell you, for those of you all who have sustained this community, those of you all have paid the taxes, those of you who have sacrificed to keep the lights on in this region, I commend you. And it is my pleasure to be here to talk about how you can empower yourselves in this billion-dollar industry. Because at the end of the day, you don't see it because you don't see it. And sometimes it takes someone from the outside to come in and to be able to show you the blessing of the opportunity that you have before you. And so that's how I feel. That's why I'm excited to be in this space, because it's a wealth of opportunity here. And we have to realize what that looks like for us. We're the most creative individuals on this planet, and we always make something out of nothing. And you have to realize and remove the fears about what you can't do and determine that you want to do something. So, Marilyn, we already know that you haven't done what you're supposed to do legislatively to empower those minority-owned firms. And so we want to have those conversations about that. But the only way you do that is if you have someone who's versed to understand what the legislation looks like across this country, and then I can come in and have a conversation with the legislators. I'll tell you, when I first got into the area, I had the fortune of sitting down with a very reputable, high-ranking elected official who was not a person of color. They knew every and anything about cannabis. They were to tell me from a national perspective what the work groups were saying and what they were reporting and how they were going to consider what that looked like for the state and the residents. I said, okay. I said, my concern is that you don't allow those individuals who have the medicinal license to just roll over into the recreational and you don't allow anyone else to get in. So that's not going to happen. I went to the people of color who were the legislators. Do you think they knew? I was deliberate in that. It let the pin drop. They didn't know. They sat there and looked at me, didn't know anything of the details about the legislation, hadn't even really thought about it, and I was really shocked. And then I was sharing something with someone. They said, well, Colette, guess what? I know someone who has some legislation, and I had read his piece, Delegate Mosby. And he agreed to have a meeting with me. And I was thankful for the legislation that he had presented to address the criminal components of cannabis and what that looked like to citizens. So I knew that he got it. And so that was my encouragement. And so there's a wealth of things that are going to happen for us in this space that is going to empower us. We got a caller. Let's see what you have to share with us today. Great afternoon to you.
Yeah, hi, Colette. How are you today?
Amazing. Thank you.
Great. First, heard you on Ann Kennard show.
Yes.
Yeah, a little while ago. And I was, you know, very, very impressed and agree with you on most, on all your points, not most of them, all of them, in reference to marijuana. But you were talking about social equity, and I just wanted to chime in with social equity and the new standard, I guess, in China, which is social credits that you receive, you know, with your social equity, and which is a benefit to, you know, the community. But I don't want to talk about, you know, the negative aspect, but just that I think that in our community, the black community, that we don't fully understand what social equity can do for us, and also how we've been sort of held back, you know, in ways with this idea of social credits, meaning that we don't understand issues, we're afraid of issues sometimes, and we're frozen in place and don't benefit from the concepts that you're talking about. I use Leafly. I started with Leafly.com.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I used to recommend that to people, but it sort of, you know, just went over people's heads. Like you said, have the medical marijuana aspect, but the I think the great benefit is going to come when marijuana becomes legalized. But again, we have to take advantage of the social credits and the equity that we can, you know, get from that. I just wanted to make that statement and just welcome you and. I have my recorder on, so I'm recording you. I do have a podcast.
Okay.
And so if you hear that you are on a podcast out there in Cyber, it'd be me.
And I don't have a problem with it. And let me tell you, anytime you want to have the direct conversation, I would welcome that.
Okay, great.
So it's no problem.
At some point, would you please give out your information and that way I could contact you? I would appreciate that.
I will absolutely do that. And I want you to stay there for 1 second because I want people to understand. Are you all familiar with social credit? The gentleman is mentioning. So if you aren't, let's stay there because you have social credit, social equity, and a lot of us think that equity and equality are the same thing. Okay? So social credit is the whole concept that if you act, you're governed. So if you act a certain way, then you'll, in essence, you'll get good grades, good points that can be used towards something. And if you don't, then you can get points and things can be taken away from you. So, for example, if you're over in China and someone shows that you didn't sweep up the street, then you could get a point taken away. If you were mean to your neighbor or did something disruptive, and if you get so many negative points, then they could take away your ability to travel. You lose your passport. It's serious. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of people say, oh, well, that's Big Brother watching. Well, yeah, but it helps govern us differently. So let me just say that's one idea. But then you have social equity. So then we say, okay, specific to this industry, that, okay, we understand that you're coming from disenfranchised communities and disadvantaged communities and you don't have these things. So we're going to create at least a conversation that makes you believe that you have a dog in the race, that you have your foot in the game. So they created social equity. Now, a lot of us think that because we step in the room, we have access into the room, that's the equality component, that automatically gives us equity. No. And I'm going to give you an example to that. Was having a work group meeting back in Michigan, and one of the individuals who was interested in opening up a dispensary in this community said, well, yeah, I mean, social equity is I own the dispensary, and then I'll employ some of those people from the community. Well, that sounds good, but let me tell you, at $10 an hour, you will never raise enough money to be able to buy your own dispensary. And when I shared that in the meeting, the gentleman got offended. And he was like, well, no, I don't agree with that. If you work for us and you save your monies, then I said, sir, there is no way at $10 an hour, someone's working 60 some hours a week. And you mean to tell me I'm going to raise enough money? Well, guess what? It'll take me 20 years to raise the money. And think about all the monies I would have raised and made for you as an employee. And you are offended because I know that there's a difference. It's a difference in just being in the room. That's like The Spook That Sat by the Door, Sam Greenlee. You all remember that? Great book. So it's more for us than just be in the room. That time is up. So many of us were just so happy to be in the room. Well, now you're in the room and you have to have something to sink your teeth in to be in the room. You need to own something. You need to want to own something and to not be afraid.
Hello.
Yes.
I just wanted to say one thing.
Please.
Just to say that we fell prey to this with Brown versus the Board of Education and the remedy being integration also.
Yes.
In a sense that we thought there was some benefit in, you know, literally sitting next to another person, and that would be some type of social equity and it wasn't really social benefit either. So, in the long run, because of the pushback that we got over the years, and we didn't do the necessary things to offset that. So, you know, I can't find any way to jump in to disagree with you. So, I'm just agreeing again.
No, I appreciate it. And guess what? And for anyone, I know some people are texting me. They want the call-in number again, so let me give it to you again.
Yep. 410. I'm going to get off and listen to you. God bless you.
Okay,
thank you very much
blessings
for the
info. To you. Thank you, and I look forward to speaking with you. So everyone, if you want to call in on this amazing station on famous 1590 AM, give us a call right now, 410-761-1592. Again, 410-761-1592. You can call in. Let's have a conversation. And to his point, you're absolutely right. I mean, and the truth of the matter is that is, and the previous show set us up for this great conversation because that's what we were told. We were indoctrinated that, guess what? As long as you're able to move out into the suburbs, then everything's going to be great for you. As long as you're able to go to their schools, then it's going to be great for you. To be able to get their books, to be able to drink their water, it's going to be great for you. And so many of us have done that. And then what? I mean, I just want to understand, after we've done all that, then what? Because we didn't have a plan. So my dad always said, mom and dad always said, that you have to know more. So you have to know what you know, and then you have to know what they know, and in addition. So I'm not mad for the individuals who went out and said, guess what? I'm going to go, and I'm going to move out to here, and I want to do these things, and I want to give my children a better opportunity. But then there was a better opportunity to do what? Because for me, I'm blessed to be able to have had an Ivy League education, and I can come back to people, my community, and give the information that I know back to empower us. Because I know that no matter what, at the end of the day, when I walk down the street in West Philadelphia, that if I did not know you from a classroom setting, you wouldn't even thought that I attended the university. How's that? And when someone sits down next to me, no matter where we are, you don't sit and know or actually assume what my pedigree is. You look at me as a woman of color, as a black woman in America, period. Until I have to open up my mouth and let you know a little bit, if when I need to give it to you, that you can't deal with me and manage me the way you manage everybody else. And that's what this whole thing is about, really. It's really about allowing us to be able to have a conversation and use examples from common conversations that will make us better, that we have to become better. And so for the cannabis industry, I look at it as the reparations. And you all can sit and disagree with me all day long, but there's no way. If the government has not given us a check up until now, I'm blessed. I'll be 49 years old. I have not seen a check, won't see a check. That's not happening. We can't get the governance to sit and not have to consistently review the Voting Rights Act. Do you know that? We're constantly, every time you look up, we have an issue about voting, voting rights. What does that look like for us? Are you serious? So we are people of color who are in that space, and we're not getting it together. You mean to tell me that they're going to give us a check? Let me tell you, you better understand what's happening with this cannabis industry right now and figure out how you can be empowered. It's just really simple, because the truth of the matter is everyone knows where the trap house is on your block. I'm just going to keep it real. Keep it real. Now, depending on how you grew up, you know where the drug house is. You know who was in control of the drug house. We are pharmaceutical entrepreneurs, have been people who are in situations that have to make the most out of life, what life has given them. When you get lemons, you make lemonade. So we know supply and demand, we know logistics, we know marketing, we know HR, employment, we know all of those things. We just now have to transfer that from the black market into the open market, and that's where the fear comes in. But I tell you right now, with individuals able to create legislation that can change everything just like that, what are you afraid of? I was having an amazing conversation with, my muse this morning, and I said, anytime you know that, like, the Wharton School now has a cannabis investment group, the Wharton School of Business has a cannabis investment group. What does that tell you? You could walk by a gentleman all day long. They might look like you think they should have been investment bankers on Wall Street, and they're actually growers of cannabis. They have hemp farms. They have transportation companies. And we're sitting up here acting like we can be a part of an industry that we've, A, sacrificed the lives of so many of our family and loved ones. And then the business of it, we know. But we're afraid and we don't want to touch it. We're going to talk about that today. I just wondered what you thought about it. And if you all might say, Colette, you know what? I don't even think about it. That's fine too, but I want you to begin thinking about it. So for example, if Maryland, there's a projection that BDS Analytics wrote up. And they said Maryland cannabis sales grow by 130%. It is to exceed $250 million by 2019. So I'm going to give that to you. Did you get that? So the grow, the sales grow, and this is just medicinal, is supposed to exceed $250 million by 2019. So if it exceeds $250 million, then you should ask yourself what the companies, the companies and entities that are providing this cannabis, how much money they're making. I know, it's a deliberate pause. I gave it to you. I want you to be specific in your thought process. Because at the end of the day, there aren't people of color, there aren't people that look like us that are reaping the benefits of this industry. Back home, for example, you could have, since we know that recreational is approved, you could grow. They have what's called Class A grow, and then they have a micro business, okay? So for example, the Class A grow under recreational, you can grow up to 100 plants. The license, the application fee is $6,000. The license is $4,000. You don't have to show the capitalization of it. And upon its, that means that I don't have to show the assets. I don't have to show how much money I have to be able to prove to you that I'm worthy of doing this business. And then upon the completion of your grow and the location, you can sell just like what our young people are doing on the corners now. Huh? But they're legitimate, licensed entrepreneurs. And if you look at all the lines of people across this nation who are partaking in cannabis, whether it is medicinal or recreational, you'll see a whole lot of people, and a lot of people in the lines aren't necessarily people of color. Did you pay attention to that? It's real. There are 33 states plus DC that have approved medicinal marijuana. There are 11 states plus DC with legal recreational marijuana. Everyone, how many states are in this union? 50? And the other ones are coming online. It is a business. It's a billion-dollar business, and I really want us to be educated on what it looks like and to be able to create a pathway. My plan, if you all want to know, Colette, what do you want to do with this? Well, my plan in this market is to, of course, have this conversation on these airwaves and then host monthly events where we can sit and talk about this industry. That is inclusive of a incubator service. A Kanna Institute is what it's actually called. It is a business incubator for the ideas and business development of cannabis. Of course, those who come and need that assistance, I will afford you that assistance, and I have an amazing team of experts to assist in that. And then we identify funding for those projects as well. So then it becomes kind of like a shark tank, if you will, for cannabis. And then so after that, and we approve, determine what works for you, then of course licensing, and you realize that a lot of these services you can take across this country. You can have license in other states. Yeah, you can. It's a business. And so it can be successful for you. That's one component of it. And then I want to have a school where you can actually have you can get certified. There's an amazing young man, Sammy Rogers, great day to you, Sammy, out of Michigan. He's the first Black-owned vocational school in Michigan, Pontiac specifically, that just opened up. And it is my hope to be able to partner with him into that service space here, in addition to having an online component as well that I am preparing to roll out. So it's an educational certification component. Those are things that we need. We have to be able to help you manifest your dreams. And even if you don't understand, if you didn't think you understood, that there are the opportunities here to be able to show you how to best do it. Because I don't want us to look back and say, I wish I could have done this. Look at what they're doing. That's real. And the opportunities are here. I've met amazing people. If I start calling off names, and you all know these folks in the community who have been here, who've been committed to us and being better in Baltimore, but they're all excited about these ideas and what the opportunities will look like for us. But first, we have to be educated, and we have to realize that it's a mindset and something that we can accomplish. We have to sit and wait for them anymore. No. We're not going to sit and wait for someone to justify and to validate you and to tell you you can do it. And let me tell you, and I know it's not for everybody. So for those of you who are interested, let me just go ahead and give you my direct contact information again. So the website is www.kannabiz.tv. And then my telephone number is area code 313-422-5751. Again, let me give that to you, 313-422-5751. So I don't hide behind anything else. It is direct access. That's what it's about. We have to be able to connect and touch each other. And I think that that's something that I haven't experienced as much in this Maryland region, Baltimore specific. There's such an apprehension of why would you help me? Why would you give me information? Why are you trying to share this with me? Because guess what? The truth of the matter is I need you as much as you need me. That we work better together. And the only way we can excel in anything is if some of us have the information and we give that back to the community. And so that's part of what we're going to engage in. We'll get models. I will go into it with you. We'll talk about the difference of cannabis, CBD, and what hemp and THC looks like, the psychoactive component of it. And we'll actually give the medicinal breakdown of it. We'll sit and talk about what banking looks like. I'll give you an example. You know that everyone who pays taxes, so you know that hopefully, and I believe that President Trump is going to take the win out of the sale of the Democratic Party. And I believe he's going to legalize cannabis from a federal level before this election. I just think that's going to happen. We'll see, but that's what I think. So once officially you can bank with cannabis dollars, because right now there are credit unions that are accepting bank funds from cannabis, but traditional banks, since it's not federally approved, you can't put money into a bank. However, did you ever think that if these wonderful dispensaries are paying their cost and their fees and their renewals and their taxes, how do you think they're paying their money? It's cash, right? And so they're paying to the state their cash. And then the state is putting that money into the bank. Do you see where I'm going with that? What's that called any other place? It's called laundering. Did you hear what I just said? And no one is even thinking about that because you're just accepting the money. They're just accepting the money, but it's not federally approved, right? So how am I paying you? And then you take it and you put it into the bank. But we don't want to have those conversations, right? Okay. If you don't understand what's in front of you and what this industry is doing, right, wrong, or indifferent, you'll be left behind. And so I'm just imploring us that there's an opportunity to not be left behind. I want to be in a space where we can have the real conversations about what the government is doing and that how we can be empowered in that. And so that's why it's exciting to me. That's why cannabis is exciting to me. And I want to hope that you're excited about it as well. I want to give you a statistic. And you all might say, okay, Colette, well, you know, I don't know if you would think that it's exciting to you, but it's exciting to me. So let me just let you know. Worldwide cannabis sales are expected to grow 853% by 2024. So we're in 2020 now. 800 worldwide cannabis sales are expected to grow by 853% by 2024. That's a new report that estimates what that looks like. So they're stating that cannabis is considered one of the hottest investment trends in this generation on Wall Street. Did you get that? That North America going green played in a big role that tripled global marijuana revenue to $10.9 billion in 2018. And that went up from $3.4 billion in 2014. Did you get that? That's global marijuana. Marijuana, just global. So if you didn't think that you had an opportunity at home, do you know Africa right now, South Africa specifically, Minister Tito just had his annual address, and he's pushing for the grow opportunity for cannabis. Lesotho is looking at what it looks like. There's, I know some amazing people out of Houston that are trying to, if Cameroon can get through its wars and its trauma, then they're looking to see what cannabis can look like there. Do you know that internationally, China, Turkey, other places are coming in to grow in Africa? Uh-huh. Did you know that? However, the legislation doesn't allow the residents and the citizens to be able to use the product. But others can come in and get licenses to grow and then export that product to is a part of this billion-dollar industry. It is a global industry. Just like what? All the commodities, sugar, wheat, cocoa, all those things. And now that's what marijuana looks like. But I know that we just don't know. We're just not aware of it. And so we just want us to be informed. That's all I want at the end of the day. And so you all think, well, Colette, guess what? Well, you're just talking about North America. No, I'm here to let you know that Europe, not just North America, will be leading the sales in 2024. How's that? Let me let you know that medical marijuana sales will outpace recreational weed revenue. Did you get that? Medical marijuana will outpace recreational revenue. I think it's fascinating. Those are things that we just don't know. There are some predictions that the U.S. will have legalized recreational pot by 2024. I believe it's right around the corner. They're stating that there's some 564 ongoing clinical trials involving cannabis. Do you know that? That's as reported from the U.S. National Library of Medicine and Prohibition Partners, that 564 clinical trials are currently ongoing that involve cannabis. And out of those 564 studies, 343 are located in the U.S., 106 in Europe, 49 in Canada, and 35 in the Middle East. Now, don't you think that these studies have real potential to improve patients' lives? Because there's a business of cannabis. I'm just asking. If you didn't know, the company GW Pharmaceuticals, and they're on the NASDAQ, they were the first company to have cannabis-derived drug approved by the FDA. So let me look. And it's called Epidiolex. Let me spell it for you. Epidiolex. Okay, Epidiolex, and it is for to reduce the seizure frequency for seizures. Childhood onset of epilepsy. How's that? And so they're trying to expand that now. And so they're working with new therapies for indications to figure out how that interacts with multiple sclerosis and autism spectrum disorder. But hello, it's the medicinal component that can save everyone's lives. But there's also a part that's the black market. I won't dispel that, that it's a big problem even in this legalized environment because folks are still going to, it's economy of scale, right? So if you can go into a dispensary and whatever an ounce goes for and whatever a pound goes for, it's a business. And I'm not mad at it. I'm just saying if there are those of us who have historically been a part of the black market, that I need you to think about something different. I need you to realize that you don't have to put your lives on the line anymore for cannabis, that you can move on over into the light and do something else, that there are other opportunities for us. And if you say, okay, I want to go back home and talk about what the revenue looks like, did you all know that California just announced that they have reached $1 billion, $1 billion in revenue off of cannabis? And of course, California is just a different animal because they've always been so proactive. I mean, years ago, 20 years ago, in everything, California is just cutting edge. But specifically, as it pertains to cannabis, the first full restaurant eatery, California. Of course, and I would be remiss if I didn't acknowledge the pioneers in Humboldt County. They're still going through trauma now, if you will, transferring over from the black market into this economy of scale. I would be remiss if I didn't talk about what happened in Kentucky. Did you all know there's an act? It's called the Volstead Act of 1921. And that was a time when there was prohibition of liquor and they had medicinal liquor. Did you know that? So that's what allowed them to be able to move up out of the space for prohibition, because you could say that the moonshine was for medical purposes. Who knew? I didn't, of course, that's research. And so I thought it was so interesting because that's similar to what they were doing with medicinal cannabis. Until they can figure out how to make it work, then it was medicinal to be able to have a set aside from recreational or the other component, the other way to look at cannabis. And so if you don't know those things, you wouldn't be able to understand and see how America is shaped. Because a lot of times we say certain things, but we do other things. And then we just create laws to be able to take what we want a step further. And so I'm just excited about that. But I was able to learn about that because there was a group, it's called the Cornbread Mafia. And they're out of Kentucky. And they were committed at a time where everyone was a community. And so they were not, they had lost, the whole prohibition came through, the whole liquor piece came through. And so they needed another revenue stream for the community. So they started farming cannabis and created international business out of Kentucky, Kentucky bluegrass, through cannabis. Kentucky, bluegrass. Who knew? So there's so many things that are happening around us, and I'm excited to be able to share those things with you. And those are some of the things that we are going to address every week on this platform. So I want you to think about, in preparation for our other conversations, if any questions that you have specifically, of course, if you said, Claire, I just really want to know a breakdown again about what is cannabis. Fine, we can talk about that. Why is cannabis an emerging market? Well, because it's $1 billion industry. And it affords an entree into the market that a lot of us wouldn't have any place else. There's a social use license that you can get. We can talk about what that looks like. Transportation, we talked about that. Security, we can talk about that. Fertilizer, those things, we can talk about that. I want to know your thoughts about cannabis. Does age influence the perception of cannabis? Are those of us who are so caught on the war on drugs and reefer madness and the impact of people of color, specifically the black community, are we just stuck in that experience that we don't want to move into another space with how we can be empowered through cannabis? Some of you might think that cannabis is a great gateway drug. I want us to be able to talk about that. Definitely, we're going to delve into how people of color and those disadvantaged and disenfranchised benefit from the industry. And then if you really want to know what social equity looks like, equality versus equity, that we should have both in this industry, what does it look like? And ultimately, the bringing home of all this is how to make it applicable right here in Maryland. So that when the people are educated, that we make better decisions about how we elect and who we elect and who we select to govern us. Because when you know better, then you do better. And we're not constantly waiting for someone to save us. You can hold your elected officials accountable for what you want to have and what you want to see. And if there's an outcome that will be gathered from it, it will be based on what you know it to be, not by what they have told you. And so that's what I'm so excited about for our time on Thursdays at 2, from 2 to 3. If it wasn't for the grace of Little Africa and the wonderful leadership here at famous 1590 AM, I wouldn't be here. And I hope that in our time through this hour that you're excited about it, that you're going to look forward to the information and the conversations that we're going to have. We're going to have guests. I'm going to have young people coming in. There's this amazing young and engaged group that I've had the pleasure of meeting here in Baltimore. And they'll be on the microphone to talk about what cannabis looks like for young people from all aspects and the perception of cannabis. We're going to have some seniors in to talk about their use of CBD and what that looks like and how it's, if you will, contrast with pharmaceutical drugs. Mm-hmm. I said it. So if we're trying to just be managed or we want to be healed, that's a conversation. We're fortunate to bring in some entrepreneurs in the industry, some physicians in the industry, those across this country who actually have brands and product and services that can talk to you about it. So you just don't think that it's some idea that can't be obtained. I want us to dream. I want us to dream big. I want us to believe that the sky is not the limit. And that at the end of the day, whatever it is that you've been presented with, then you can create it. And even if it doesn't seem like you can do it here, it's doable. And there's always a market for something. But you have to realize that it's more than what you see it to be. I think in all of us, what we're going through with this coronavirus, that people have been told what to do, and they're looking in a space where government has said it has to be this way. And I believe that with this whole awakening for all of us, you better realize that you have to do something else. Hello? If anything, because this whole stimulus package that's going to be presented, I know the SBA has talked about some loans for some small businesses, but that's not everybody. Everybody's not going to get that check. So where are you? And if cannabis isn't your thing, that's fine. But whatever it is your thing, are you going to create something where you will be empowered so that when life happens and community happens and this world happens to you, you won't be held hostage yet again? Because I look at that as a form of slavery. And we've done that already. We've been there, done that. How'd that work out for us? We're free. What do you say? We use free now. We's free. And we need to start acting like that. And so I want you to have some takeaways that the beautiful part of being free is a mindset. That as a man thinketh, so is he. But the freedom is to think. And you have to realize that who gives you the information, why do they give you the information the way that they do? Because there's always a position for that. And it's okay to question. So many of us have been indoctrinated into a system and an ideology that we don't question things because we were taught not to question. But it's totally refreshing when you have a conversation with someone who's never been a part of the system. And they constantly keep pushing you and they constantly implore you to just look at things different, to move out of that matrix, to get up out of this space and what we call the twilight zone. It's real, everyone. And there's an opportunity right here. And I am so fortunate to be able to know that on Thursdays right here on famous 1590 AM, we'll have that conversation to discuss the business of cannabis. And so I hope that you're excited. You know that you can contact me. I'm going to give it the contact information again, www.kennabiz.tv. That's I put up probably every day, every other day. It's an all video platform where you can watch the actual news footage and information from across this country, from all the areas of legislative, medicinal, recreational, product and service, and other, so that you can be best informed about what it looks like and how it can be applicable to us. And then you can share that with your friends and with your family members. It's an amazing young lady. I hope to have her on the air. She and her family, they own a dispensary out of D.C. And Marion Maine is a name, woman of color. That's amazing. So sometimes we have to believe that we can do better when we get examples. Just as the previous show said, we don't have the examples that we used to have. And for those of us who had the examples of, if it was the hustler on the street, or just like it was the preacher in the pulpit, if it was the mailman, if it was your neighbors coming out, those were examples. And it was up for us to have a takeaway from it. Because out of anything that's presented to you, there's always something good. That leadership, there's something to be said. Being free, having independence, there's something to be said about all of that. So I am thankful that that is the space that we will be walking in. And I just hope that you stay encouraged, know that you will be educated, enlightened, and empowered. You'll consider legalizing it, as Peter Tosh said. So everyone, thank you so much for your time. Look forward to seeing you next Thursday at 2 p.m. for more Kanna Biz, discussing the business of the cannabis industry.